For the first time, we are seeing the immediate aftermath of a fire in the country's only nuclear waste dump. It happened just days before a radiation leak that shut the place down and got WIPP fined for hazardous waste violations. Action 7 reporter Megan Cruz has the pictures and video you'll see only on 7.
They're never before seen photos and videos of the waste isolation pilot plant after a February fire. The U.S. Department of Energy says a salt truck burst into flames inside the mine. It took officials some time to make sure it was safe to go underground, but once they did, they took hundreds of pictures and shot video to help figure out what happened. You see energy officials focus on the truck. It's charred and covered in soot. As they walk around the mine, you see more fire damage. Investigators later said the truck caught fire after flammable materials on the truck got too close to a hot surface. Six workers that day were taken to the hospital for smoke inhalation. At least one of those workers is now suing WIPP. He claims to have developed some serious health problems following the fire.
When I'm coughing, it gets so hard that my head hurts. It's like my brain is pounding.
Just a few days later, there was a radiation leak in a different part of the facility. 22 workers were exposed to small amounts of radiation. Since then, the Department of Energy has been fined $54 million for hazardous waste violations. WIPP has been closed ever since and may not resume operations until 2016. Megan Cruz, KOAT Action 7 News.
We contacted the Department of Energy for comment on the story. They did not call us back.
Well, this is odd. Apparently, you can get more radiation from licking your iPhone charger. Yeah, I kid you not. This is according to Fran Williams, a technical advisor in New Mexico, Carlsbad. And they are talking about they're down to the levels of licking your iPhone charger.
And so there is no expectation that those measurements for you or your children or anyone else will show exposure on the lung count. They're down to the levels of licking your iPhone charger. And I'm not trying to be funny, I'm trying to equate radiation exposure to something that you can understand.
Now, you don't get radioactive isotopes from licking your iPhone charger. And I don't think Apple is going to be very happy to use that. So don't throw away your iPhone yet. Unless she's right. And of course she's not right, because radiation, if you ingest radiation, you never get rid of it. And to use an iPhone is because you can't use the bananas or potatoes or background radiation or water anymore, because we destroyed that narrative, because that's potassium 40. And if you drink 7,000 becquerels potassium 40 in your water, which is legal, it's irrelevant because you off-gas 7,000 becquerels of potassium 40. And if you eat a banana with 12 becquerels of potassium 40, you off-gas 12 becquerels of potassium 40. But if you ingest plutonium or americium or uranium-238, your body attacks it and it gets a tumor. It lodges in your bones, your muscles. It affects your DNA, and it does a lot of damage. And it goes right into your lungs. You know, all these studies, you had Dr. Raymond Gilmedy, who practiced on beagle puppies for over 3 decades at Loveless, down there in New Mexico. I think he's in New Mexico, Oklahoma City area. And they showed that even the most tiniest examples of plutonium will cause serious cancer and kill the puppies and the dogs. And that's barbaric, but I mean, they've done that, and I covered that before about WIPP, when they call me the C word, which is conspiracy, not the other word. And I'm not a conspiracist, I'm a researcher. Now, for them to equate licking your iPhone charger means they're extremely desperate at this stage.
They're down to the levels of licking your iPhone charger.
And it's a total fabrication. If you wanted to equate the radiation that comes from these places, you might say, well, why do you have to wear expensive masks? Why do you got to wear expensive suits if it's not harmful to us? Why do you have to wear it? Why are you putting it half a mile under the ground if it's not dangerous? And how come you never went back down in that mine after you had the alleged truck fire and all that smoke was coming out of there? Didn't that block up all your filters right then and there? Isn't that what smoke does? You ever seen a smoke fire in somebody's house? You ever see the carnage that creates? Well, that wasn't a smoke fire. They would have went back down there after the fire was out, because truck fires are not that dangerous, okay, once the smoke clears out. So that was a radiation. They covered up as a truck. They've been covering it up ever since. It hemorrhaged out of that place. We have the footage. And these are radioactive plumes. They lied repeatedly, constantly, and consistently, compares it to bananas.
Dr. John Nail, a professor of chemistry at Oklahoma City University, and even healthy foods aren't 100% healthy.
Most people will get more radiation exposure from eating bananas than they ever will from this New Mexico repository site.
Compares it to x-rays.
WIPP scientists say radiation levels are far below some of those in our everyday lives, like from medical x-rays and natural sources.
Compares it to walking in the sun, compares it to flying on a plane.
It's serious, but they insist that the radiation levels detected in and around the plant in the last 10 days are no riskier than a dental x-ray or an airline flight.
And none of them have anything to do with radioactive fallout. None of them. So they're lying. They're nonsense. She's selling her soul by implying you get more radiation from licking your iPhone charger, because you get no radiation from licking your iPhone charger. They have nothing to do with each other. She's obviously not qualified to be doing that job, and she is qualified to sell her soul because that's what she's doing there tonight. I'd be definitely worried at this stage if they're going to keep lying like that. This is what they do. They just lie and lie and lie. For some reason, they can't tell you the truth. It's because this stuff is bad. It's plutonium. It's uranium-238, uranium-234, 235. They were stuffing it all down there. They don't put insignificant waste a half mile underground. They only put the highly toxic stuff. That fire is all the proof you need, okay? Take care, folks.
I'm Mayor Dale Janway, and I want to thank you all for participating in our WIPP Town Hall meeting, and it's also being broadcast live by Red Rocket. We have some special guests here this evening. We have Beverly Allen Nananis with Senator Udall's office, Diana Ventura with Senator Heinrich's office, and Bernadette Granger with Congressman Steve Pierce's office. We have Daniel Santos, a board member, Defense Nuclear Facility Safety Board, and John Posco, who's also the group lead with that. We have Dr. Martin Simon here with NMED. John Heaton will be our moderator tonight, and the presentation will be delivered by Dana Bryson with the Department of Energy's Carlsbad Field Office, and Jim Blankenhorn and Tammy Reynolds with the Nuclear Waste Partnership. I know it isn't on the agenda tonight, but everyone's mind is on the negotiations related to the compliance order between the state and the Department of Energy. WIPP is extremely important to the nation, and getting WIPP opened again is vital. We certainly encourage everyone to be willing to negotiate. The focus should always be on building for a better future. Thank you all for your interest in WIPP. I'm going to now turn it over to John Heaton.
Are you all ready for action? Again, thank you everyone for being here, and those of you that are online. Same rules will prevail. We'll go to questions in the audience here first, and then we'll go to questions online. And those questions that we're unable to get to in the hour and a half we have allotted, we will try to answer those online for you. So without further ado, again, I think I want to welcome our friends from the Defense Nuclear Facility Safety Board. That's a five-member panel that oversees almost all the nuclear facilities, I guess, in the United States. They're a busy bunch of people. And I'm sure Mr. Pasco is equally as busy as a staff member. So they are missing two people on that five-member board right now. And Daniel tells me that within the next couple of weeks they'll be submitting. Well, shortly they'll be submitting applicants for that to the Senate for approval. So with that, Joe Franco is unable to be here tonight, so Dana Bryson, his very able assistant, will take over his position. So Dana, thank you.
Thank you, John. And welcome. Thank you for being here. We've got a good story for you. We're working to the recovery baseline. We've had some good progress. We successfully completed the REACH project, and the Accident Investigation Board is using that information to finalize their third report. We're restoring the underground using bolting to maintain the ground safe, and contamination mitigation, and we'll be talking about that tonight. The bolting is a necessary prerequisite to getting into panel 6 to complete our initial closure activities, and we're getting close to starting on that as well. And just yesterday, we completed the mod filter in the HEPA bank replacement out at the site. We'd done that previously, and this was the second replacement, and Tammy will be talking more on that as well. We've tried to maintain our outreach efforts. This is one very important part of that. We've also done stakeholder briefings with the New Mexico legislature and Carlsbad Small Business. We had an emergency management regional response workshop. And we're just want to try and keep to our commitment to being transparent and open with you. So along those lines, I'll turn over to Tammy to fill you in on the details.
Thank you, Dana, and good evening. Good to see some familiar faces out there. Let me start with bolting. As Dana indicated, bolting is a very significant part of recovery because it's part of maintaining the underground infrastructure in a safe condition. And so that is one of our top priorities. We started bolting back in November of last year. And if you look at the map, the green area, quite a large area, and what that represents is the amount of catch-up bolting that we have now completed in the underground. And that's a combination of bolting in the clean areas as well as the contaminated areas. And so this area right here up to the north, those are all the clean areas that we've completed the bolting in, and then south of that is the contaminated bolting. So we started in November in the clean areas. In January, we started in the contaminated areas. And then the second week of February, we started a back shift. And the back shift is focused on bolting. So now we're bolting on day and back shifts. And the teams are making very good progress in the bolting area. In fact, some of the original projections, they've actually, for the most part, doubled those original projections of how many bolts that they would replace in a day. And what that means in the green area is now that we've caught up on the bolting, we're now in just the routine maintenance of those areas. So we're very pleased with the progress being made there. And the focus right now is towards, in the contaminated area, it's towards the panel 6 so that we can start that closure. So this area right here, headed towards the entrance side of panel 6, is where we're focusing the efforts on contaminated bolting. And as soon as we finish getting to the entrance side, then while the bulkhead is being installed, the bolting team will continue down this direction and then over to the exhaust side of panel 6. So good progress. And then the other item that I wanted to talk about is Dana indicated we did just finish replacing the moderate efficiency filters on the ventilation system. We knew that being in filtration mode that we're going to generate, as we conduct activities in the underground, we're going to generate salt dust. And that salt dust is going to carry through the exhaust system and onto the filters. And so last June, after the events, we replaced the moderate and the high efficiency filters on both of the filter units. We have two units that run in parallel, and we took some time last June and replaced those because the pressure on those filters was getting to a point where we needed to go in and do that. And so with the activities in the underground, the pressure started building up on the moderate filters, which are the first set of filters in both of these units. You have the moderate filters, there's 21 on each unit, then you have high efficiency filters, 21 of them, and then you have two sets of HEPA filters on each unit. So you've got four stages of filters. Now, what's significant about this, if you think back to last June, last year when we did this evolution, we had to bring in some folks from another site because our NWP employees had never performed this task in a radiological situation. And so we brought in some folks that, you know, had done this or do this on a routine basis to help coach and mentor them through that evolution. Well, this time our folks did this on their own. So they planned the work activities, they mocked up and practiced dressing out and, you know, wearing the respirators to do this activity, and it was an extremely successful activity. They demonstrated very good conduct of operations, the safety was outstanding, and so on Tuesday and Wednesday of this week, our employees completed that activity, and now we're back into our normal entries, and I'm continuing our recovery work. So we're extremely proud of the efforts that they put forth into making this a very successful evolution. And during that process, from the last bullet on the slide, the surveys that we had performed for this activity showed a significant less amount of contamination than the activity last June, which we would have expected because that was right after the event. And so it just confirmed that the activity levels and the contamination was less than what we had experienced last June. Okay. So that's my update. So now I will turn it over to Jim.
Okay, good evening. So as I was walking in, someone asked me a couple of questions, but it dawned on me it wasn't on either Tammy's slides or mine. So I want to take just a couple minutes before I talk about contamination in the underground and give the team some updates on a couple of other items. The first question was related to panel 6 closure, and Tammy just described to you the progress that the team is making to gain access to panel 6 to start the interim closure of that panel. And just to remind everybody what that means. So on that drift that Tammy showed you coming into 2750, right down through here, in that area we had already put salt up against the waste, and we had hung brattice cloth and chain link. Now, we haven't anchored the brattice cloth and the chain link yet, so as we gain access to that side, we'll have to anchor the brattice cloth and the chain link, and then we're going to install a metal bulkhead. And that metal bulkhead is already in the underground. It's already been fabricated. It's ready to be moved down, and then it'll be put into position. Now, on the other side, when we go back up and around to South 3080, to this entrance to panel 6, same process, but we have not put the run-of-mine salt yet up against the waste, and we haven't hung the brattice cloth or the chain link. So we're going to be moving salt, clean salt down that's currently stored just past the salt hoist down in this area. We've got excess salt that we had previously mined that we had not yet brought up to the surface. It's clean. We're going to take it down, put it up against the waste face, then we'll hang the brattice cloth, the chain link, and again, we'll put another metal bulkhead up, and that metal bulkhead is also in the underground, and it's already fabricated. The other question was how we're doing on electrical. We talked about bolting, and I'm going to talk about decontamination and fixing, but the other item that we've been statusing you on is the electrical systems in the underground. We've been doing a great deal of cleaning. We're doing cleaning for two reasons. We started off doing cleaning of all the electrical components because of the soot that had settled onto those components, and the risk was as we energize or de-energize those components, we could get arc flashing from that carbon soot. But we're also finding a lot of salt buildup in these systems. So the team is methodically going through, and I think I mentioned to you last time, we've got a little over 650 components in the underground that we have to clean. And they're making great progress on that. I think, Tammy, they're 70% But the other notable piece of information was that we restored power to the north end of the mine, where our science teams are working, and we've also put in redundant power to the north end of the mine. Now we're continuing to work on the south end of the mine, which is now contaminated, but the team is working in that direction, and then they'll be working to finish the installation of a new switch station for substation 4, which will allow us to then put the second feed of electrical power to the underground. So team's making great progress on that, and I hope to, in the next month or two, we'll be able to tell you that we've got that all complete. And then the final thing that I wanted to the question that I wanted to answer coming in that was asked was, where are we on the ventilation projects? And I want to talk about the interim ventilation and the supplemental ventilations. So again, I'll just remind everybody that we set up three different projects. The first project was to increase the HEPA, the filtered capacity that we have, which all of our air is currently running through our filtered system, and it's about 60,000 CFM. And Tammy just talked to you about the HEPA change or the filter change that we just did on the mod filters. But we're going to add two new fans with two new filter trains. And those filter trains have been fabricated. They have been tested, and we should receive the first of those filter trains should arrive on site with its fan unit, should arrive on site sometime the week of March 16th. And then a week after that, we expect the second unit to arrive. Now that's just the big, bulky equipment. We've still got the ductwork that's currently being fabricated, and it'll be shipped. And then we've got all the work on site to pour new concrete pads, to bring electrical systems in play, to bring all the civil work that needs to be done to take all that equipment, install it, and then connect it up with the existing system. But right now, all of that is on schedule to be completely installed and ready for us to take it through its startup and testing in the June timeframe. So that's making great progress. The supplemental ventilation system is the second project, and that's the one where we've been talking about that we're going to put a new fan in the underground somewhere in the vicinity of the AIS, the auxiliary air intake shaft, and we're going to pull air into the underground, positively pressurize that part of the underground, the clean side, and then push that air back out through the salt shaft. So the fans have been procured, at least they've been ordered. They haven't been received yet, but the requisition has been dropped. And we're now working on the design of the bulkheads that we'll have to put in the underground to configure the mine. And the way we're going to configure it is all of the areas that are potentially contaminated, all that air will continue to be pulled through the filtered system. The rest of the underground will be run on a second circuit, and it'll run through this supplemental system, and it'll be pushed out through the salt, which will be unfiltered. So that project is currently moving along as well, and I think our latest schedule showed it about mid-August. So we're looking to have that ready for startup and testing in the August timeframe. The interim ventilation system will essentially double our filtered capacity. It'll take us from 60 to about 114,000 CFM of air. And just for reference, remember, we normally used to run at about 450,000. So we're not, that doesn't take us all the way back, but it gives us double what we have today. And then the supplemental will add another 140,000 or so of air in, and then we expect to get, the way after that gets split in the underground, to see about a 60,000 to 70,000 total increase in the underground. So it'll take us up to about 200,000 total. Okay, and that's the position we'll be in and that we'll operate under for several years until the line item project to install a new permanent ventilation system is runs through the CD process we've talked about several times, and runs through that process and we get that into place. So that's the update on the two ventilation systems. Now, I was asked what my presentation's about is we've had this discussion a couple of times, a couple of questions, let me say it that way, about what are the radiological conditions in the underground. And so what I want to talk about today is the general characterization of the underground. You've seen a map similar to this in previous presentations where we've showed you all the areas that we rolled back to controlled areas, and that's primarily all these green areas that you see up on the screen. But now we put some numbers to this. So these areas are below, have been surveyed to below the regulatory limits, and we're using a MARSIMS type analysis and sampling regime to do that. So we take surveys, we take samples on some frequency and some measured distance along the entire surface of those areas, and then we're using the most restrictive, let me say it differently, the most conservative limits that the Department of Energy uses for characterization. Basically, these areas have to be below 20 D per M disintegrations per minute per 100 centimeters squared of removable alpha, and they have to be less than 100 disintegrations per minute per 100 centimeters squared alpha for total. So that would include both the fixed and the removable. Now, before I go through and talk about the other areas and some of the other numbers that are on this chart, let me just give everybody a few reminders. Remember that what we're dealing with as a result of the radiological event was a drum that had in it plutonium and americium. Those two radioisotopes radioactively decay by alpha decay. Now, alpha contamination or alpha radiation is primarily an internal hazard. And what do I mean by that? What I mean by that is the alpha particle itself, when it comes off of the americium or plutonium, it is so large of a particle that it interacts with things very quickly. So as it moves through air, it interacts with the molecules in the air, with the nitrogen and oxygen. And it interacts with them to such a level that it will only move 2 or 3 inches from the source term. So if I had a particle of plutonium in my hand right now, and I held it up, the alpha radiation would only radiate 2 or 3 inches from my hand. So that's how it acts in air. It also can be stopped if I took that same plutonium and I held it in my hand and I set a piece of paper right up next to it, the alpha particles would not move through the paper. The paper is thick enough that it would effectively shield the alpha radiation from moving those 2 or 3 inches in air.
As well as your skin.
And so anything that looks or has sort of the same properties of a piece of paper, like the PPE that we put our folks in, or the skin, as long as it's not cut, or as long as it doesn't have any abrasions on it, your skin would effectively stop alpha contamination. Now, so when we talk about alpha and we talk about how we protect our workers, what we're really concerned about is protecting them from any type of internal uptake. So how would alpha particles get in the body? Well, the way it would get in the body is through inhalation, through absorption, or through injection. And so we talked about the PPE. Tammy has given a couple of demonstrations of the PPE that we wear or put our folks in. That protective equipment is designed to encapsulate the body to keep the alpha particles away from the body. So if it deposits, it's going to deposit on the outside of the protective equipment, and then it will not penetrate that, so the individual receives no dose. We also then put them in respirators. And so we've got our folks in respirators that are designed to provide a protection factor of over 1,000. These respirators then protect the individual so that they don't inhale any alpha particles. They can't ingest it. We don't allow people to eat or drink or chew gum or smoke while they're in contamination areas. And then again, the protective equipment, we check everybody out before they go in, but the PPE also helps protect people from getting cuts or abrasions that might then provide a path for the alpha particles to get in the body. Now, if alpha material gets inside your body, I just told you, externally to your body, it causes next to no damage. If it gets internal to the body, it has a very high potential of causing very high damage because it tends to move towards the bones of the body, specifically plutonium, and then it sits in one spot and it simply continues to irradiate. So it causes a lot of localized damage. So everything that we do is about protecting our workers from the alpha contamination and preventing it from getting inside the body. So I wanted to remind everybody of what the risk was, and now I'm going to talk two different terms to you tonight. I'm going to talk about exposure, and then I'm going to talk about contamination. And let me start with exposure because that tends to be what everybody asks about, but it's not the real risk. When we talk about exposure, again, I'll remind everybody, in the United States, everybody receives, just through your normal life, whether you smoke cigarettes or eat bananas or have smoke detectors in your house or go get dentals or have x-rays done or sit in front of the TV too long, especially the old ones, you're exposed to natural radiation. We get it from the sun, we get it from the soils, we get it from the rocks. So there is natural, what is classified as background radiation that occurs, and the average individual in the United States gets 620 millirem per year, okay? Now, to put that in perspective for you, in panel 7, where we had the radiological release, the general area surveys that we do are less than 1 millirem per hour. So if you went and stood right next to the waste for an hour, you'd get 1 millirem of exposure. Now compare that to the 620 you're going to get every year. Our workers so far, because this is alpha again, and remember it has a very short distance that it'll move, not only do we use shielding, not only do we use the PPE, but we use distance. So we keep our folks several feet away from the waste face. By doing that, we essentially, since we've been doing recovery, the exposures, the maximum exposures to all of our workers during recovery has essentially been zero. It's been nothing more than background. Now, Tammy talked about the fact that on our filters, we saw a little bit of radiation. The numbers I just gave you were in terms of millirem, a thousandth, one one-thousandth of a rem. On our filters, we measured about 14 microrem. So that's one one-millionth or 14 millionths of a rem. Now, the reason we were seeing that residual amount of radiation is because, again, we've got two different isotopes that were in that drum. One was plutonium, one was americium. While both of those isotopes primarily are alpha emitters, they decay by alpha, americium-241 does have a very small gamma signature. Gamma gives your body dose, okay? Alpha won't, gamma does. So that's why we see a little bit of dose build up on the filters over a period of time, but very, very small numbers. As I mentioned, it's 14 millionths of a rem, and the limit that we all get comparing that to background is 620 millirem per year. So in the underground, from a dose perspective, external dose, our workers have got essentially zero from the recovery efforts. Now let me switch gears on you and talk about contamination. And contamination is where the alpha material comes back into play. So we are measuring alpha contamination in the underground. Now, what is difficult to do without a PhD and or a couple of PhDs is to convert contamination, D per M, to a dose. Again, remember, because it has a lot to do with how close you are to that material, whether it's protected or unprotected, shielded or unshielded, what type of isotope it is. A lot of different variables play into that. So it's very hard to draw a correlation between contamination levels that I'm going to talk about and any dose. But remember, our workers have been working in this area, in these contamination areas, and they haven't received any dose to date. Okay, just to keep that in perspective. Okay, so What the map shows you, and I've showed you a similar map in the past when I talked about our approach to do decontamination and to fix the contamination in the underground. What this map is showing you is that we've got essentially four different areas in the underground. We've got the controlled area that's in green, that's been rolled back, and that essentially is below the regulatory limits, which I mentioned to you, we're using 20 and 100. The yellow areas are the very lightly contaminated areas outside of the panels, and those are anywhere from 200 up to about, or those are anywhere from that 100 that I mentioned up to 200. We have had folks in the underground now doing surveys of this area, and in many cases, while we've got the whole area painted yellow, because we're doing general area surveys, in many of these areas, we're in fact not finding very much contamination at all, much less than the 200, or even much less than the 100 that we use as our regulatory limit. So it's very lightly contaminated, and in this area, remember, our approach is going to be that we're going to use a water spray. We're going to rely on the hydroscopic properties of the salt, and we're going to wet the salt down and allow it to then recrystallize, and when it does so, it fixes any contamination that might be on the floor primarily, with just a little bit on the ribs. We haven't found anything on the back yet. It's all been on the floor and just slightly up on the ribs. So we're going to be using a water spray, and we've been using a water spray, and I'm going to talk to our decon progress to date once we get through with this chart. In panel 7 itself and in the exhaust drift, I've talked to you about a different approach that we're going to use. We've talked about using a water spray first to try to fix as much of the contamination as we can, and then we're going to put down, if that doesn't seal it, then we're going to put down a paint sealant, and then we're going to come back on top of that, and we're going to lay down a Brattas cloth that's a different color than the paint, and then we're going to put clean salt on top of the Brattas cloth. So we'll have basically white salt, a yellow Brattas cloth, and probably black paint. So we'll have three different colors, and we'll do that to encapsulate the waste underneath the floor. The reason for the different colors is very similar to a hazardous waste facility. When you break through one barrier, you'll be able to tell because you'll see the color of the next one, and at that point in time, you'll know that you need to go do a repair. The objective is always to never get to that final color. You always fix it when you see the first color. So we use those as indicators so that we can control the contamination and keep it buried and isolated from our workers. Now, I don't think we're going to get, well, I know we're not going to get panel 7 and the exhaust drift totally fixed. We're always going to have some residual contamination that's going to be on the ribs or on the walls. And so in those areas we've talked about in the past, those areas will continue to be operated as contaminated areas. So our folks will still be in protective equipment. They'll still have respiratory equipment with them. And we'll continue to work in those areas until we fill that panel and work ourselves out of that area. So in panel 7, you can see the orange, and you can see the orange just outside of panel 7 and at the entrance of panel 6. We've seen slightly elevated levels between 200 and 2,000. And then inside of panel 7, down at room 7, and again up in the exhaust drift, you can see that we've got general area surveys that are greater than 2,000. And so to bound that for you, if you'll remember back in May and June when we were doing our initial entries, we talked about some of the readings that we were getting in panel 7. The highest value that we saw in panel 7 was about 60,000 disintegrations per minute per 100 centimeters squared. A piece of equipment sitting in room 6 that we've been deconning, the highest contamination levels that it had on it was about 18,000 disintegrations per minute per 100 centimeters squared. Up in the exhaust drift, in that red area up at the top, We've been seeing, again, that area is also greater than 2,000. On average, we saw in that area, as we've been doing surveys, between about 7,000 and 15,000 disintegrations per minute per 100 centimeters squared. Now, what we've also been noticing is that over time, as the mine itself reacts to the humidity that gets pulled through it over time, that hydrostatic principle that I talked to you about, that we're going to accelerate by spraying, it actually has been doing that on its own. As humidity has gone into the underground, it's created moisture. The salt itself is wicking the materials that are on the surface into the salt matrix. So I don't have any data for you today that would say it's reduced it by some percentage or some number, but we are seeing, we're gathering that data, and we are seeing over time that the mine is naturally by itself starting to fix that contamination and reduce the transferable contamination in these areas. We're going to accelerate that by going through these decon processes that I'm going to talk to you about next. And I'm trying not to confuse the issue, but we've thrown so many terms out at you at the past that I'm going to give you one more data point. I talked about dose from radiation, and I talked about alpha contamination and what it does and what its properties are. The other item that you've heard us talk about on numerous occasions is the airborne contamination. And we refer to that in terms of DAC hour, derived air concentration per hour. Now that one I can do a conversion for you. One DAC hour is the equivalent of 2.5 millirem per year. So if you stood in an area that had one DAC hour, measured at one DAC hour, and you had no respiratory protection, and you stayed in there, and you breathed that for 8 hours, you'd receive, for the year, you'd receive 2.5 millirem. Okay? So that when we put our folks in respirators, that's really what we're protecting them against. As that alpha contamination goes airborne and is in the air, we then can measure it in terms of derived air concentration per hour. When we first went into panel 7, we saw readings as high as 126 DAC hour. Now since then, if we go in today in panel 7, we see something generally in the range of 5 to 10 DAC hour. And remember, I told you earlier on that the respirators that we provide our workers have a 1,000 times protection factor, and they're in an area that has 10 DAC hours, so they're more than protected. But those are, so when you hear us talk about air contamination or DAC hour, that's what we're talking about. It's a measurement of the contamination that has gone airborne, and that our folks have to worry about their breathing zone. So contamination, exposure from radiation, and then the derived air concentration, which is the airborne concentration. Okay, so I know I threw a lot out at you. We'll probably have to go over that a few more times if folks are interested, but there's been a lot of questions, and so hopefully that'll help clarify some of the questions. Let me switch and talk now just a couple of minutes about contamination and what we're doing about mitigating that. So I described to you our contamination and our fixing approach that we're going to use. We've procured some new equipment. So far, we've been sending folks in the underground with handheld sprayers, and they've been spraying down the ribs and the floors. And actually, I'm going to go back a slide. I'm going to show you exactly where they've been doing that. And so far, they have decontaminated the area from West 30, right here, up to East 140, down and then back. So that this U-shaped area, our guys have been in there. Remember, that area is measured at less than 200 disintegrations per minute per hour. They've been in there with handheld sprayers, spraying down the ribs and the floor, and they've gone back in and surveyed after they've done that, and they've got no detectable. So it's working. It's driving any contamination that we have to the floor, and then it's fixing it in the salt on the floor to the point where it's now not transferable. Now, what we're doing with the spray cart is now we're gonna upscale this from a handheld sprayer to something a little bit more robust. This will allow us to drive down the drifts. It'll allow us to spray the ribs and the floor and the back, and allows us to cover much areas much quicker. We actually put this into service today, and we're going to be using this in the East 140 drift. And I'm going to switch back in a minute and show you what we're going to do to clean the floors leading up to panel 7. The HEPA vac system, the bottom right, that's another system that we bought. This is an industrial size system. It gets towed behind a vehicle. It's trailer mounted. Basically what this is going to allow us to do, it's a large vacuum that has HEPA filters on it, much like the HEPA filters we talk about on our ventilation system. And we're going to use this in areas where there is loose contamination, where we simply can vacuum it up and reduce the source term. Our guys are this is in the underground today, and the guys are currently training on it, and we expect to put this into service in about a week or so. Now I'm going to go back one more time to this chart, and you can see the dividing line between the clean areas and the slightly contaminated areas, green to yellow, right at about the south 1950. Right here. What the teams are going to do is they're going to start with that gator-mounted sprayer that I just showed you, and they're going to drive, while they're spraying, they're going to drive down East 140 till they get about this intersection, so this area right here. And then what they're going to do is, after they've sprayed the walls, the ribs, and they've sprayed the floors, then we're going to come in right behind the sprayer, and we're going to lay brattice cloth. And then we're going to come back in right behind that. We're going to go to the clean side again. We're going to pick up salt, and we're going to dump salt right there at that interface and push it forward. And we'll continue to push the salt forward over the brattice cloth and create a clean floor as we move. The guys affectionately call that laying a yellow brick road. It's not the term I probably would have called it, but they like it, so we're going to stay with that. They're going to create this road, a clean road, and then once they get to that intersection, they're going to make the turn, and we're going to do the same thing down to the entrance of panel 7. That will then become the configuration that we're going to use to be able to take people, equipment, and eventually waste in a clean route down to the panel, and then at the panel we'll have an interface and a transition point where we'll transition from clean to contaminated. We'll pick it up on the contaminated side then and move it into the panel for disposal until we're able to fill the panel and move out of it. Okay, so I think, Dana, I'm going to stop there and kick it to John. Unless, did you have a follow-up? Okay.
Any other questions? Any other comments? Okay, questions from the audience. Anybody here? Mary?
When I was looking at the map, we have these white areas in panel 1. Can you tell me what those are?
Yes, we can.
Just very curious.
Yep. I think I know exactly what you're talking about, so let's, yeah. So Tammy, you want to talk to this one, or you want me to? All right, so this is panel 1. You're talking about these these rooms right here in panel 1. So that's panel 1. Remember, that's the first panel that we mined. And before we had completely filled that area with waste, those rooms had started to close. It's the salt had started. Remember, we built it many, many years before we started putting waste in it. Mm-hmm. And those rooms started to close. So we basically abandoned them. Left them empty. There's no waste in those rooms. You can see where the waste is in the other rooms. Mm-hmm. But that was the very first panel, and it really is just a function of how long it took us to get started. From the time we constructed it to the time we started placing waste, we simply ran out of time as those started to converge. Remember, the pressure in the underground is such that there's 2,100 pounds per square inch pushing in every direction. So the floor buckles and comes up, the back comes down, and all the sides start to come in. And so that's basically what happened in those areas.
Okay, I'm going to sneak in a couple other questions. I'd like to know if you, in panel 7, if you had any plans before you put people in there about a roof collapse. For instance, when you were in there, those with the boom, you had people in there. Did you have like a contingency plan in case something like that happened?
Yeah, so maybe this is a great topic maybe for another town hall, but I can answer it briefly here. But there's a lot of detail to this answer, and that's why I said we maybe we'll come back with a more detailed response for you. Remember that in the underground, we constantly are measuring that movement that I talked about in those rooms that close. We're constantly measuring that. We've got guys that are doing actual measurements in the underground. We've got electronic equipment that is measuring that movement in the underground. And our folks, every one of our workers is trained as a miner to inspect the areas that they're working in. So for panel 7, our guys had been in there evaluating that the conditions of panel 7 every time they go in, but more importantly, our ground control guys were monitoring it both visually and electronically continuously. Now we put bolts in, that's what Tammy was talking about, all those bolts we're putting in, that's because we do that as we see areas of movement. We put the bolts in to secure and slow down that movement. So panel 7 is also bolted, and so we go in and we monitor the bolt patterns that are in there as well. So the answer to your question is we're always prepared for some type of roof fall in the underground. Our folks are constantly prepared for that. They're trained on how to respond to it. They're trained also on how to inspect to make sure the areas they're in are not prone or are at risk for that. And so that's just I don't want to say it's a part of doing business, but it really is a part of maintaining a mine. And so our guys are trained. We had done all the inspections, and we didn't see any issues in panel 7, and we still haven't seen any issues in panel 7.
And Mary, when we made our initial entries and started classifying the mine and assuring that it was safe, we would go in with a team, and you'd have one guy who's a rad controls guy who would be monitoring for radiological hazards, and you'd have a ground control guy with you. We had acceptance criteria for looking at how many bolts had broken, you know, while we were out of there, and safety was foremost in what we were doing. We wanted to reclaim the mine, but we didn't want to put people at risk.
Okay, thank you. And I also had a question about panel 6 and panel 7, radiological and contaminated areas. I've heard that panel 6 is more contaminated than the area around panel 7. Can you tell me whether that's true or not? Or?
Yeah, so Mary, I think I'm going to answer your question two ways. I'm going to say that the map that you're seeing up there shows that the area outside of panel 6 is orange. So it's not red. Red would be the highly contaminated areas that we have, or the areas that are greater than 2,000. The orange areas are between 200 and 2,000. But you'll notice all the rest of the areas outside of panel 6 are yellow, which is the very lightly contaminated. Now and the other thing that people might be, the rumor might be that somehow containers have failed in panel 6 and therefore there's contamination. We have no evidence that any containers have breached in panel 6, and so it would be just as it was when we emplaced the containers, and there is no contamination on the outside of the containers when we emplaced them. So it's still in the same clean condition it was when we initially closed and finished putting containers in there.
Okay.
You know that, and we've had studies, you know, a lot of work was done on WIPP before we even started putting waste in. One of the studies that was done, we know that these panels are going to close in and eventually crush and isolate the waste in place. And the studies confirmed that with the bulkheads in place on the rooms, that if you had that happen and crushed a drum, several drums, you wouldn't see it move out into the rest of the mine. That's why we do the bulkheads and the closure process we do.
Let me say something. Mary has been our most loyal attendee. She's been, I think, at every town hall meeting, and really, I think, knows more about all of this than maybe all the rest of us. She really asks very good probing questions, and Mary, I just want to thank you for being here, because you really do a great job of asking really good questions, so thank you. Norbert?
One of the things that was said before all these incidents happened at WIPP was that WIPP actually, and it's actually a fact, it's that WIPP was actually, the underground had a subpar radiological background. That's actually why the scientists are down there. So conditions were less radioactive underground, and I assume they still are today, than the surface is. Furthermore, to just maybe make that statement more pointed, WIPP underground actually acted as a filter. The air that came out of WIPP was less radioactive than the air that went in as a result of radon plating out on the salt. So with that being said, I found the explanations by Mr. Blankenhorn quite interesting, but there's still one very significant missing element, and that is putting all these numbers and all these data into context, into a context that actually tells us what the real risk is. And that context would be, for example, we have up on the surface in the United States and worldwide high background areas, for example, high background radon areas. And I'm sure, please correct me if I'm wrong, that when you have a high radon background area, you measure that basically also in DAC per hour, because essentially you have the radon daughters that you're measuring, and those are the particulates in the air. So I would challenge you to actually tell me, maybe not today, but maybe the next time, and put it on the web too, by the way, how the maximum DAC per hour rate that you expect to encounter in the underground at WIPP compares to the DAC per hour rate in some high background radon areas, US and worldwide, because I'm reasonably sure that anything you find at WIPP is going to be far less than areas where people live in high radon background areas and live there without protective suits.
We can do that, Norbert, but I think there's something very important that needs to be identified. And if somebody chooses to live in that area, if somebody chooses to live at elevation and chooses to have that increased radiological exposure, that's one thing. But the Department of Energy is committed to the ALARA concept, which is as low as reasonably achievable. And we are committed to minimizing the exposure of our workers, and that is why we take these precautions.
It's point, counterpoint. Yes, and that is that the DOE is also, or has prided itself in the past, I don't know whether it still is doing that, as one of the premier science agencies in the country, or the premier science agency in the country, and therefore, the science has advanced well beyond this ALARA, and they said every additional particle is dangerous to your health, and every little additional radiation is dangerous to your health. So I think there's a conflict within DOE between what is the actual status on the leading edge of science and knowledge and the regulation. There's a gigantic gap between those two. But let me maybe ask another question and make another point sort of involved in that is, and I brought it up during the last town hall meeting that I attended. We have so far, or you have so far, found absolutely no radiological contamination in Station A ever since the incident, correct?
In Station A?
Yeah, there has been no radio. The only alarms that you had in Station A were these radon daughter alarms, correct?
We have been getting consistently low levels, and as we do more activity in the underground, those low levels increase. But for the rest of the public, I know Norbert knows this, Station A is before it gets to the filters.
Correct, right. And you have really not found any, that station has never alarmed so far except for radon, correct? In other words, let me go beyond that. In other words, you have no evidence that significant particles emitting alphas have actually made it to Station A. That means despite all the activities that you have had so far, you don't seem to have stirred up enough dust to actually make any difference at Station A. That is before the filters. On top of that, of course, you know, the filters themselves were only slightly contaminated.
We haven't seen significant above regulatory type levels, but we have seen increases in levels.
Well,
and we do have measurable levels there.
But the point that I have made in the past, and I'm going to make again, is that you really have no indication yet as to what level of ventilation would actually remove enough contamination to harm anybody or to be harmful to anybody underground. Therefore, you still haven't made the point why you need, even to begin with, either the interim nor the supplemental ventilation nor the shaft. There has been no technical scientific point made with the risk explained and quantified to actually justify doing any of these things.
I understand your concern, Norbert, and if we went down that path, we would end up doing an analysis of cost to risk. And again, we are going down the path of as low as reasonably achievable. And if we can minimize exposure to our personnel, either in the underground, on the surface, whatever, we will take those reasonable measures.
Norbert, they don't have any alternative but to look at regulation.
Fine, but let's put them on the record on that.
Yeah.
We are also committed to following RCRA and all legal drivers, and I'm not going to second guess our regulators.
Okay, other questions from the audience? Let me ask one. Since the electrical has been reestablished in the north end, does this mean that the high energy physics studies and those other studies can be reinitiated?
So what the teams are doing right now, they still have, once we establish the electrical, now they've got to go and get all of their equipment cleaned up. And so at some point, yes, but right now there's still a significant amount of work that they're currently doing to clean up the individual pieces of their equipment before they can actually energize
those.
Okay,
but now they have access.
They have access.
Okay.
And they're down there on a daily basis doing that work.
Okay, because those were some very important physics studies that were going on, and expensive on top of that, and a lot of critical material that could be lost if it's not utilized. So, good. Okay, back, we're off to the...
Okay, just to let everybody know, things have been running fine on the web. We've had around 25 participants throughout the evening, and I've got about 8 questions, and we'll go down and see if anybody has any other. Have the workers in the underground had bioassays to determine if there's been any intake of plutonium or americium?
So the workers are on a bioassay program, and so they have samples that are submitted periodically, and there's been no intakes.
Since the
events, that's correct.
I know Mr. Blankenhorn addressed this, but he also forecast that it would probably come up again. Plutonium-239 and americium-241 also emit gamma rays and X-rays. What is the basis of the assertion that these isotopes only emit alpha particles?
I think I did say during my talk that I did acknowledge that they did also have, in addition to alpha, they had gamma emitters. I didn't mention the X-rays because they're even smaller, but they do have a gamma signature. It's a very small number, and that's when I was, if you'll remember, that's when I was talking about dose at the waste face is less than 1 millirem, and that dose primarily comes from the gamma emitters that are in our waste streams. And then up on our filters, I mentioned to you that there is a small dose in the microrem levels, and that was attributed to the gamma signature that comes from americium.
And there was a follow-up question. Does the 1 millirem, you said that dose measured near underground waste was less than 1 millirem per hour. Does the 1 millirem per hour also include neutron components?
Yeah, that's a total dose measurement that they're taking. So it would include gamma and neutron and open window beta, but it all averages out to less than 1 millirem.
Question, why are you preparing to seal the primary accident evidence site before the AIB report has been released?
I wish we were actually that efficient and I could close room 7, panel 7 that fast, or room 6, but we're probably a couple of different things, first of all. The AIB agreed and the state of New Mexico agreed that we could proceed with the closure of panel 6 expeditiously before the AIB had completed their investigation. And so we've been working in that regard. Now, we're not going to have panel 6 closed before the AIB issues its report. The last word that we received was that they were looking to have that issued by the end of this quarter, so by the end of this month. On room 7, panel 7, we, again, everybody agreed, and it was stipulated in the order that we received from NMED, that we wouldn't commence closure on room 7, panel 7, until the AIB had concluded its investigation. So I mentioned to you, all I talked about tonight was the closure of panel 6. I didn't mention anything about the closure of room 7, panel 7. That will occur after panel 6 is closed. It also still requires that NMED approve the interim closure that we proposed. So until we get that approval back, we won't start on room 7, panel 7, but that'll be well after the AIB issues its report.
You want me to take a couple more, or do we have some people in the audience?
There's also the technical advisory team that will come out with a report, and also a peer review that will occur immediately thereafter. And so whether or not it will be closed before the peer review occurs is probably questionable. So I would guess there would be no point in it until all those reports are in.
Okay, and we've heard this one, but I'll ask it again. Why have you continued to avoid answering questions about why the hundreds of radioactive survey readings have not been released to the public? Why are you not releasing the hundreds of underground DPM readings to the public?
So we at some point in time are going to do that. This was our first attempt to give folks a general idea of the conditions in the underground. Putting all of those reports, which are thousands and thousands of pages, on the internet without explanation and without a lot of supporting information that goes with it will quite frankly be data that can be easily misunderstood. So we have a lot of work going on right now to compile all of that information, get it into an easily readable format, and then provide all of the description that needs to go with it. So that's the path forward. The time it's going to take to do that is pretty considerable, because we've taken, as I mentioned, thousands, tens of thousands of readings in the underground. What we're trying to do today was just start with giving folks an idea of what the cumulative or summary of all those different measurements have been.
Take a couple more? Okay. A question about the revision to the DSA. Will there now be safety limits on the WIPP where there are now none and there is no explicit or implicit margin of safety?
I think what that question is getting to is, in the documented safety analysis, there is a section titled safety limits. That section is pretty much limited to specialized nuclear facilities like reactors, and because they hazard category 2-3 facilities don't typically use that section, does not mean that there are no safety limits. That is a specific application. If you look in your DSA and in your technical safety requirements, you have nothing but safety limits in there. And so just because the safety limits section is not used does not mean that safety limits are not included.
Okay, I've got two more that were asked before we got to the questions, and I may miss any that follow through while I'm asking them. I'm not responsible for that. Are there any more expected ceiling failures or collapse areas? I believe when the collapse happened, that it was kind of noted that this was something that to some degree was anticipated.
So as Jim mentioned earlier, we continuously on a daily basis monitor the underground. We've got a system that captures that data for us automatically, and then we have personnel. Everybody in the underground is trained to monitor that, as well as we have specific people, geotechnical folks, crews that go through and monitor. Right now, there's no, you know, imminent failures that we've seen of any areas. But again, the salt does move, and so it's just on a continuous basis. We'll continue to monitor it to see if we do see another suspect area that could come up. That's just part of the nature of the way the salt behaves. But right now, there's nothing imminent that we are seeing at this point.
Okay. Oh, let me do one more, maybe with a different. What has been the resuspension of americium and plutonium from the contaminated areas to the clean areas because of airflow and recoil from the high energy alpha?
We're starting to get into PhD level stuff now, and I'm not a PhD, so we're in trouble. So let me try to break that question down maybe into a couple of different answers. The first question would be, how much resuspension are we seeing of alpha material from the contaminated area to the clean air? So we have not seen any migration of contamination from the areas that we have rolled back clean to controlled areas. We haven't seen any migration of contamination across those boundaries that we've established. Now the other question has to do with the way that alpha particles react in air currents and air eddies and air streams in general. There's also a phenomenon called recoil, which is how alpha particles tend to move in different media. In our facilities, we're not seeing, because of the large areas that we're talking about, we're not seeing significant migration of alpha from the areas when it gets resuspended. Most of the alpha contamination that we're dealing with is either fixed or it's transferable. The fixed is tending to stay fixed. We're not seeing it get resuspended as a result of the recoil. The stuff that is still transferable, the alpha that is still transferable, I'm sure it is moving, but the air flows are the predominant factor that is moving the alpha particles. In other words, if you leave alpha particles in an isolated area without any airflow, they'll have motion due to this recoil phenomenon. But the airflow that we have is much more significant than that internal recoil property that it has. So it's overwhelming any of those reactions. So the airflow is what's keeping the alpha in the locations that it's in. I know that was sort of an odd answer to the question, but it was a pretty sophisticated question for those that made sense to. Oh, Norbert, if you're going to challenge me on that one, I'm sitting back down.
Okay. No, I'm not, and I'm not a PhD either, by the way. I was wondering, you gave some numbers for the DAC per hour for panel 7 at first after the incident, and then now about 5 to 10. Do you have any DAC per hour data for the E300 exhaust drift? Where are they compared to?
Yeah, I think we do, Norbert. I'm sure we do, because I've had folks in there, and Radcon's been in there. I don't know what they are.
Were they? Do you know whether they were higher than the initial rates in panel 7 or lower?
The feedback I got was that they were lower, but I just don't know. So that would be less than 10, but I don't know what the numbers were. So let me get back to you on that one.
Okay.
I'll get you some actual data.
But then sort of a follow-up on what we discussed a little earlier. The Department of Energy, in especially the capabilities that the national labs have, has probably the finest competency and ability for risk assessment in the whole world. And I would challenge both the Department of Energy and the national labs, and maybe the DNFSB should challenge them too, instead of just saying, that's the regulation, that's what we have to comply with, those are our borderlines, regardless of whether the science tells us this stuff is really risky or really dangerous, to make a real risk assessment, an independent risk assessment of what is the real risk at WIPP, rather than hiding behind these regulations. Because we have had reassessments of the risk. We have had reassessments of the ALARA principle, which is a stupid principle to begin with, ever since at least the 1980s. We are not acting here according to the most recent standard of science. We're not really acting according to the standard of science that we had 20, 25, or 30 years ago. And in the light of spending hundreds of millions of dollars prospectively for solutions to problems that may not even exist, from a taxpayer perspective, I find that an absolute scandal. And I find it amazing that nobody seems interested in actually addressing that. Not the Department of Energy, not the independent CMERC, not the national labs. We're talking about this as if there was no knowledge about that. It's out there. We are just ignoring it. And why are we doing this? This is happening and wasting taxpayers' money.
All right. Any other questions? Any other?
How frequent are the bioassays to the workers?
They're done periodically based upon when people, what work scope people are doing. Typically it's quarterly. I personally had bioassays after the event, and then I got my little bottle to fill quarterly after that.
So typically quarterly. Yeah. Mr. Santos, you want to comment on recoil? Or Abe, you want to comment on recoil? Okay. All right. Any other questions or comments? Mary?
I just want to say that I'm interested in this recoil, and I'm interested, and I know Norbert isn't, and I'm interested in why, you know, we have smoke detectors on our ceiling, and down there we only have them like 5 or 6 feet, and I'm wondering what's going over the top of them. And I'm interested in all these man-made isotopes because I think maybe they don't react the same as other things. So this is what I think a lot of people are interested in. And if you address it, even though we don't understand it, I think it, you know, it's good.
Very good point.
Yeah.
Okay.
And Mary, in your smoke detector, when you go home and you look in it, and you open the cover and you look at that little bitty thing that says americium, and look at that, and that's what we're talking about. The reason that's safe in your smoke detector is that it's solidified and it's solid, and you can't breathe it in, and the alpha radiation from it wouldn't go through the skin on your hand.
And it's on the ceiling because typically smoke rises. Okay, any other comments? Thank you very, very much. Oh, Abe, you're going to do a little dissertation on recoil or risk? You want to talk about risk?
Well, no, I have some sympathy for the position that Mr. Rempe presents, but at the same time, I know that we live in a regulated world, and that the UNSCEAR report has looked at all the data and said we're going to stay because we want to be conservative, not because we want to be scientific, but we want to be conservative and not take chances. We're going to stay with the linear no threshold hypothesis. That is what informs our regulators, and by law, that is what we comply with. So you're asking us to rebel against our laws, our orders, and our regulators, which is not a fair thing to ask. Now, if you ask for Congress to give the national laboratories money to investigate low doses, I would welcome that kind of research. In fact, DOE has a low-dose research organization at headquarters. Yes. About recoil, don't forget that these particles in this waste are very small to start with, extremely small, and so they're easily swept up in wind. Recoil, when that alpha leaves the americium, it'll shove it and break larger particles into smaller ones. These are already so small, recoil is not going to have an effect of basically introducing more into the air. It's just not going to do it because it's already down to a very, very small nanometer particle size. That's all I wanted to say. And when you say these are man-made, if you go to Oklo in Gabon in Africa, you can find them there in the natural reactors. They were active 2 billion years ago. And if you go to thorium deposits like in Brazil, you will also find some of these products that we thought we were the first ones to create, but Mother Nature beat us to them long, long ago.
Thank you, Dr. Van Leeuwen.
Thank you very much for those comments. So with that, thank you once again, everyone, for being here. And we especially thank our guests from D.C. that have made it. And those of you online, thank you very much. And we'll look forward to seeing you the first of next month.
Now, for them to equate licking your iPhone charger means they're extremely desperate at this stage.
They're lying on the levels of licking your iPhone charger.
And it's a total fabrication. If you wanted to equate the radiation that comes from these places, you might say, well, why do you have to wear expensive masks? Why do you got to wear expensive suits if it's not harmful to us? Why do you have to wear it? Why are you putting it half a mile under the ground if it's not dangerous? And how come you never went back down in that mine after you had the alleged truck fire and all that smoke was coming out of there? Didn't that block up all your filters right then and there? Isn't that what smoke does? You ever seen a smoke fire in somebody's house? You ever see the carnage that creates? Well, that wasn't a smoke fire. They would have went back down there after the fire was out, because truck fires are not that dangerous, okay, once the smoke clears out. So that was a radiation. They covered up as a truck. They've been covering it up ever since. It hemorrhaged out of that place. We have the footage. And these are radioactive plumes. They lied repeatedly, constantly, and consistently, compares it to bananas.
Dr. John Nail, a professor of chemistry at Oklahoma City University, and even healthy foods aren't 100% healthy.
Most people will get more radiation exposure from eating bananas than they ever will from this New Mexico repository site.
Compares it to x-rays.
WIPP scientists say radiation levels are far below some of those in our everyday lives, like from medical x-rays and natural sources.
Compares it to walking in the sun, compares it to flying on a plane.
It's serious, but they insist that the radiation levels detected in and around the plant in the last 10 days are no riskier than a dental x-ray or an airline flight.
And none of them have anything to do with radioactive fallout. None of them. So they're lying, they're nonsense. She's selling her soul by implying you get more radiation from licking your iPhone charger, because you get no radiation from licking your iPhone charger. They have nothing to do with each other. She's obviously not qualified to be doing that job, and she is qualified to sell her soul because that's what she's doing there tonight. I'd be definitely worried at this stage if they're going to keep lying like that. This is what they do. They just lie and lie and lie. For some reason, they can't tell you the truth. It's because this stuff is bad. It's plutonium. It's uranium-238, uranium-234, 235. They were stuffing it all down there. They don't put insignificant waste a half mile underground. They only put the highly toxic stuff disguised as insignificant stuff.